Welcome to episode 115 of 10 Minute Record Reviews. And if you haven't subscribed, please do. There's a link at the end of the review. Today I'm going to talk about John Coltrane's album from 1957, his second as a leader, Blue Train, recorded on Blue Note. This, of course, is one of the albums which gets mentioned occasionally when people talk about Coltrane's greatest albums. It's a transitional record for him. He's post-drug addiction. He spent this very cathartic period with Monk, and he's developed whole new sounds, which he's then going to go on and develop in his second stint with Miles Davis's quintet. Coltrane, of course, had previously been playing with the Davis Quintet, but he'd been fired in early 1957 because of his heroin habit. Davis had been chewing him out for some time over this, both in private and in public. Some of these fights had actually been witnessed by Monk. Eventually, in April 1957, Davis has had it. He fires Coltrane. He also fires his drummer, Philly Joe Jones, both of whom were junkies. This, as Coltrane himself said in numerous subsequent interviews, was a huge wake-up call. He goes home to Philadelphia. He gets clean. He also becomes intensely spiritual at this time. This is a real period of awakening for him. And he returns to New York City a changed man. In coming back to New York from this brief period of isolation, he connects with another recent exile, Thelonious Monk. For most of the 1950s, Monk, who was a genius of 20th century jazz, was victimized by a particularly discriminatory tactic of the NYPD, and this was known as the cabaret card. In order to perform in any New York establishment that served alcohol, you had to have a cabaret card. And the people who decided whether or not you had a cabaret card were the NYPD. They could grant cabaret cards, they could withdraw cabaret cards, and they could confiscate your cabaret card if they had any sense that you were involved in narcotics, even if there had been no criminal conviction whatsoever. Monk had previously had his cabaret card withdrawn in 1948 for a drug bust. In 1951, he's sitting in a car with Bud Powell, the legendary jazz pianist, and Powell gets busted for drugs. Monk refuses to testify, and because he refuses to testify against Powell, the NYPD yank his cabaret card, which means that Monk cannot play in the city of New York, which is the absolute epicenter of jazz, between 1951 and 1957. He makes do, he records some great albums elsewhere, he plays other parts of the country, but he's basically cut out of the nerve center in the prime of his career because he would not testify in a drug trial against a friend of his. Monk, of course, wasn't the only person victimized this way. So was Billie Holiday, so was Charlie Parker, so was Jackie McLean, all suspended from earning a livelihood on the whim of the NYPD. The five spot was opened in 1956 by a couple of brothers who grew up in the Bowery, Joe and Iggy Termini. It quickly becomes a jazz and beat counterculture epicenter, and so people like Kerouac, Ginsberg, de Kooning, and others are all hanging out there, and the best jazz musicians are coming in. The Termini brothers knew what had happened to Monk and his suspension, and, possibly because they're white, they were able to intervene with the NYPD and to help Monk get his card back. So Monk gets a six-month gig at the Five Spot, and 2 weeks into that, he brings in Coltrane to be part of his quartet. This album was recorded in the midst of that 1957 stint with Monk at the Five Spot. Sadly, aside from one tape recording of kind of iffy quality made by Coltrane's wife, there are no live recordings of this particular six-month engagement. But it's well known at this time that Coltrane is developing rapidly. He and Monk are throwing ideas around offstage, they're working them out on stage, and Coltrane is developing rapidly. In particular, he's developing what would become known as his sheets of sound approach, which of course is his famous soloing style with these rapid arpeggios where the notes are so fast they almost flow together like a glissando. In his previous tenure with Miles Davis, Davis had been quite controlling about the duration of Coltrane's improvisations on stage. No such restrictions from Monk, who when Coltrane was soloing and experimenting, frankly, on stage, would get off the stage, would go get a drink, and then would dance around listening, sometimes for upwards of half an hour. Full of new ideas and enthusiasm, Coltrane enters the studio on September 15, 1957 to make this album, and it's made that day. As a side issue, it's kind of interesting that this is Coltrane's only album for Blue Note, which of course is probably the most famous label in all of jazz. How did this happen? Well, the previous winter of 56-57, this is when Coltrane is still playing in his first stint with Davis, he goes up to Blue Note Studios to ask Alfred Lion if he can get some Sidney Bechet records, Sidney Bechet, the old alto saxophonist. They get to chatting, and Lion says to Coltrane, "How about a contract for you to record some albums as a leader?" And Coltrane says, "Sure, it sounds good." They agree in a small advance, which would require Coltrane to make at least one album for Blue Note. Just then, apparently, Lion's office cat jumps out of the window and onto the street, and Lion looks out of the window and the cat has been picked up by a lady and she's taking it into a cab with her. So he rushes out into the street, stops the cab, grabs the cat, brings it back into the office, but in the intervening period, Coltrane has left. There'd been no paperwork signed, and so the contract was only a handshake. Coltrane never returns to Blue Note's offices, and in 1957, he then signs a contract to record records for Prestige, but he remembers the handshake deal with Lion, and he wants to honor it. So he calls up Lion and says, I'd like to do that one album we talked about, and so this is the album which gets made, his one and only for Blue Note. Lion himself produces a session, and they bring in Rudy Van Gelder as the engineer, and so, of course, the quality of the recording is excellent. The lineup for Blue Train is Coltrane on tenor, of course, Kenny Drew on piano, two of Coltrane's bandmates from the Miles Davis days, Paul Chambers on bass and Philly Joe Jones, the other person who'd been fired that day. And incidentally, both Chambers and Jones had worked with Kenny Drew previously. He'd released a solo album earlier in 1957 called Tough Piano Trio, which itself is a minor classic. There are two other horn players, and they're excellent players. Lee Morgan, who's a total up-and-comer, would eventually be a real superstar in the 1960s, and Curtis Fuller on trombone, and it's really hard to think of this album, and in particular, the title track, without the flavor of that trombone. Coltrane himself writes all the songs except for one standard, which is Old Fashioned. The album starts with the title track, Blue Train, with that famous riff, and it always sounds to me like Coltrane just can't wait to get started in this song. It's as if he's, to use the train metaphor, I guess, pulling into a station on a train, and just as the train slows down, he's just waiting to that moment where it's going slow enough so he can jump onto the platform and run. He's right into it from the very start. There's so much urgency to his playing. Then you get a solo from Lee Morgan, which I think is totally joyful. Then we have Curtis Fuller's trombone, and underneath that, Philly Joe Jones starts to play double time for a while, and then he returns to single time. It's kind of an interesting little touch. This song, of course, is a blues, and when Kenny Drew's turn comes to solo on piano, he plays a very bluesy solo, probably the bluesiest moment of the whole record. Chambers has a short bass solo towards the very end, and I almost think this is kind of unusual because of the way it's recorded, which is, to my ears, kind of poorly. Van Gelder was normally totally fastidious about the cleanliness of the sound he got from each instrument. This, by contrast with almost everything else he does, is kind of muddy sounding, which is a bit odd. Anyway, the main riff comes back in. 11 minutes has gone by just like that. This is a timeless, classic jazz performance. The second and concluding track on side one is Moment's Notice, which is kind of an upbeat bop piece. It's maybe on this song where you get the best glimpse of that nascent sheets of sound approach that Coltrane was developing, not so much the beginning of the solo, but as it wears on. The other horn players had to be amazed at what they were hearing, but they rose to the challenge, and both Fuller and Morgan offer some really rapid-fire stuff in response. Interestingly, on this track, Chambers' bass solo is played with a bow. Side two starts with Locomotion, which is more fast-paced blues. Just like the first side, Coltrane is almost falling over himself to get into it. His solo starts even during the head arrangement at the very start of the song. Fuller and Morgan are both soloing at about 100 miles an hour, and there's a drum solo here too from Philly Joe Jones, which is punctuated by some pretty epic rolls on snare. Then finally, after all this fast-paced stuff, there's a breather with the standard I'm Old Fashioned by Jerome Kerr and Johnny Mercer. The playing on this is absolutely beautiful, and it kind of conjures up some of the more accessible stuff that Coltrane would do in the midst of his impulse years when he was getting nudged by Bob Thiel to do some recordings that would actually appeal to a more traditional jazz audience. Coltrane was, of course, a big acolyte of people like Charlie Parker, and he was nothing if not a modernist and nothing if not somebody who was willing to toss aside old conventions. But where he always had a bit of traditionalism was in his reverence for ballads. And this probably comes from his time with Johnny Hodges, who, of course, was a master of melody and a master ballad player. Because whenever Coltrane does play a ballad, he's never rushing through it. You never get the sense that it's tossed off. Instead, is always a sense of reverence. You hear this on his Impulse albums, and you hear it here on I'm Old Fashioned. The final track is Lazy Bird, which is based on a Tad Dameron composition of the same title, but significantly altered here by Coltrane. As the title suggests, this was a bit of a nod to Charlie Parker. It's amazing at this point, 1957, how long this guy's shadow was amongst all of the saxophonists who would go on to become giants of the field in the 1960s. That said, this is all a little bit less frenetic. It's also got, interestingly, another bowed solo by Chambers. It's a nice piece of music and a nice capstone for the record. Coltrane is developing month by month here, and he's surrounded by an all-star cast. Maybe all the songs don't quite measure up to the quality of the title track, but the quality is still very, very high. He has his shit together again, he's returning to form, and he'd soon be invited back into the fold with Davis, but the truth was that it wouldn't be long before he'd outgrow that role. He couldn't be a sideman to anybody after 1960, even Miles Davis. This album is one of Coltrane's career highlights, a contender certainly for the best thing he ever did before he joined Impulse. It's an essential listen, and it's 5 out of 5.